Okay, let's call the meeting to attention. So we have a little extra time today because we're missing a couple of speakers who are due to illness, couldn't come. So we're starting a little bit late, but this shouldn't be a problem. What we're going to do is we'll starting whenever we begin with Michael Hawrylycz in just a minute. We're going to just push the whole schedule back past the from the nominal times by, say, 7 minutes or whatever the starting delay is. So everything will start about 7 minutes behind schedule. And that shouldn't be a problem because at the end of the day, we're ending early anyway. So let's begin the second day of the Causality and Big Data Conference with Michael Hawrylycz, and we'll just go forward.
Thank you. I'd like to thank the NAS and Sackler organization, and Rich in particular, for spearheading this, who did certainly the bulk of the work in making this happen. And it's very great to be here. So I'm going to talk about work that is done at this place here called the Allen Institute for Brain Science. This is kind of will be a sort of a big data with a nod toward causality. I'm not a causality researcher per se, although we are in aspects of this sort of touch upon important, I think, aspects in that work. So we're a nonprofit medical research public organization that's privately funded, but public in the sense that all our resources, part of our mandate to make all of our resources open and accessible. And as we generate big data, we make it available right away before we even attempt to publish on it ourselves. And so a lot of the stuff's out there. This picture here is not our actual building, but it's a building that will be ready for us on September 15th. Right now we're scattered in several buildings in Seattle. So we start with this picture here, which is a picture that comes from Sally Mann, a volume called Immediate Family. And it's a picture, I think the name of the picture is called Candy Cigarette. And it's sort of, it just uses sort of iconographic kind of picture of loaded with all kinds of imagery and implications. And the question is, you know, how does our brain infer everything that we see in this picture? And how could a machine approach actually understanding what is kind of said here? So in the spirit of this kind of thing, we want to approach problems like this. As been pointed out, the complexity of the brain, you know, is astonishing. It's a cliche now to call, basically to call the brain the most complicated piece of matter in the known universe. But upon any kind of investigation into it, one is really daunted by its remarkable complexity. And you know, we need not review here the number of neurons of various mammalian organisms and their connections, but of course it's astonishing. I put by a point of comparison here the Google Lynette, one of the most, you know, sophisticated kind of deep learning kind of image based kind of classification algorithms, which have sort of performed astonishingly in a great deal of sort of classification of images on the web. And for the point of view is that there are many aspects of this that we do in our brain that we still kind of would like to understand that are beyond the capability of such systems presently. This sort of slide here is kind of nice. It comes from actually a David Hubel, a famous individual in the study of neuronal firing patterns and their significance is in the visual cortex of the cat originally in the work of it. And what's it does in some way summarize in a lot of aspects of the state of kind of modern neuroscience, where you have this idea that we understand components, receptors of the kind of the cell types in the retina are very well understood, the structure and the cell classification and their connections. And in fact, we understand that how the connectivity proceeds through the lateral geniculate nucleus in the thalamus and moves into visual cortex and stuff. And then there's this sort of like thing down here that basically memory, thought, and soul are just sort of this place in the diagram where it's not clear. Well, it must happen somewhere here. So this is the to be illustrated kind of part of the program. A lot of what we know about the visual system, its architecture, was kind of studied in the macaque. And there's sort of seminal work of Fellerman and Van Essen, where they basically histologically looked at a great deal of sort of macaque imagery histologically and cut sections and made track tracing and mapped out really the visual architecture of the macaque brain. It's not as easy to work with such animals. We wanted to sort of to do things that we can do to scale, which is part of the kind of the way we approach problems. And it's not so much that visual processing in the mouse is necessarily so important, although it appears that mice actually have reasonably sophisticated visual capabilities compared to what may have been thought, but that it provides a nice starting point for understanding cortical circuitry and the function of circuitry. We largely think that cortical circuitry is more or less kind of repurposed across the cortex. Different specialized circuits perform in auditory cortex, visual cortex, somatosensory, etc. And the visual cortex, what's nice is it provides an entry point to understanding because you can control stimulus. And that's not the case in a lot of other aspects of cortex input. One of the most kind of pronounced in popular theories of this was developed by Tommy Poggio from MIT and his colleagues, which in some ways has been influential both in the development of neural architectures, artificial neural architectures, and in building machine kind of representations of vision. It's called HMAX. HMAX stands for, basically an invariant object recognition system, attempting to mimic or build a model of how visual perception may work in the early visual system. And the notion is just that essentially input comes in and much like a artificial neural net, essentially feature local features of orientation, basically bandwidth and other aspects are sort of computed, and these are generalized, passed up into more and more complex cell types, which enable kind of a classification. These simple objects, operations have been observed in biology in these famous experiments of Hubel and Wiesel, where they exposed studying the cat cortex, able to find specific simple cells that respond to orientation gratings that will fire only when a grating is let's say in a vertical direction and significantly less in other directions. They indicate that one of the first operations that the visual cortex does is basically an edge detection, and that this information is essentially wrapped up into more and more complex computations as it kind of moves up the kind of the visual stream. And this HMAX, in fact, is quite good at this model, at basically characterizing and classifying images. That for images that are exposed to humans for let's say less than 100 milliseconds, this model and machines based on this, in fact, do better than humans do. But as the time goes beyond, let's say 100 milliseconds, where we have a chance to really cognitively understand the content, then humans start to do quite a bit better. So one of the places where these models kind of fail are simple, where things become occluded, right? We start to block off pieces of the image, and if you were to only see certain components, Our generalization capabilities are substantially enhanced over anything that we can presently model. And so the question becomes, you know, how do we do that? How do we address these kinds of tasks? And so we've chosen, because we tend to work in these sort of high throughput systems, and we want to build large kind of controllable kind of experiments where we can take things to scale, and we had a lot of experience in the mouse. We've chosen to move from, say, some of our prior work, which has been more just gene expression studies and other studies of sort of morphology, into studying kind of more functional studies in the mouse. Now, the visual architecture of the mouse is not as sophisticated as the macaque, maybe, but it has a lot of the same areas, maybe 10 to 12 areas in the kind of primary visual system, so-called V1, where largely the edge detection and basic kind of characterization takes place, and these higher areas. And this was sort of summarized in important work in 2007 by Quanjin Wang and Burkhalter. Quanjin Wang is now at the Allen Institute. And the question becomes, can and how do mice recognize objects? So we have this experiment that we've designed, which is basically a very controlled kind of thing where a mouse can be essentially running on, and this is a very generalizable experiment because you will see variations of this and refinements, but that the mouse just basically is running in a constant way on a kind of wheel, and there's a sort of head kind of contraption fixed to the mouse where one can do either 2-photon or calcium imaging or other types of things. And when objects of a given nature come by, if it's the object that you want them to recognize, they're rewarded for that with some water or some other attractive solution. And otherwise, there's no reward. And the question is, you know, they will stop and actually respond to this. And one can measure various things. One can look at individual neural firing patterns. One can look at more kind of mesoscale kind of circuit dynamics. One can look at concurrent firing of neurons to understand what the mouse is perceiving and what they may deduce from that. So how do you approach a problem? How do you approach these problems? We have kind of broken this down into just a sort of this framework, which is, you know, not necessarily so either unusual or perhaps novel, but at least it's convenient for kind of classifying this work into basic kind of things. And that becomes a components, a kind of computation and cognition kind of axes of this. And it's a bit of a deconstructionist kind of approach, where imagine you had a cell phone, someone hands you a cell phone, and you want to know, how does this contraption work? Well, you might blow it apart and try to understand what do the individual components do, the receiver, circuits, transistors, et cetera. Then you might ask, you might test it for its computation. And finally, you might try to understand more global properties of it, some of which wouldn't apply here. But these are some of the characteristics that one can apply to this kind of paradigm. So let's start, I want to review some of these and how we would approach some of these paradigms. So historically, we have been more in the space of this component space. And a lot of the work that we've done in the past has been building of these large-scale gene expression atlases and profiling systems. For the original work that was completed in 2006, it was a large-scale in situ hybridization map of the mouse brain, which sort of profiled gene expression in 22,000 transcripts in the mouse brain. An illustration of that is shown in the upper left-hand picture up here, where you basically see essentially this is a gene, a type of growth factor, ETV1. It shows kind of expression in a sort of a semi-quantitative approach where one can measure gene expression. And it's all run in these high-throughput systems using these robotics, as shown below. Or generalizing to the human, here's a picture that is just appearing in a recent paper that I just finished. It's just showing a kind of consensus map of the brain-wide, what is the nature of differential expression of genes in the human brain common to six individuals. So it's showing it's basically counts of the number of genes which are common to all individuals, these six individuals, and are essentially differentially expressed. So you see some really interesting characteristics of this. One is in the upper left-hand corner, a cortex. From a gene expression point of view, the cortex is comparatively homogeneous, except for that one band there, this cross band, which is indeed the visual cortex in the human. Or down below, that this block right there, which is pure blue, which is the cerebellum. And the cerebellum, although it's intimately involved in kind of, you know, our learning of motion, repetitive activities, how you might learn to play the piano in some sort of kinesthetic sense, apparently there are no genes that are reproducibly different between the compartments of the cerebellum between individuals. It's just a very, very homogeneous kind of structure. So we want to bring this kind of components approach to this problem we're talking about of cognition and understanding. And so, of course, now you have to add other things. Gene expression alone is not the only picture in that. So what are the components that we choose to kind of add to this mix? And one, of course, the two are electrophysiology and the morphology. And it's really the three of those, the transcriptomics, the electrophysiology, and the morphology, which essentially complete the picture of neuronal structure and its kind of characteristics. So from an electrophysiological point of view, you want to classify these cells. So there's a very different signature between excitatory cells and inhibitory cells. Those would essentially act as feedback and slowing down the circuit. Without both, you can't really build an effective circuit, and you can't do kind of advanced computation with only kind of a feed-forward kind of system. You got to have some way of slowing it down, of knowing when to turn off and enhancing other operations. So what we do is we profile these cells. We use single cell kind of techniques to extract and record in vivo, in living vivo animal, as well as in vitro. The cells survive when they're taken in slices for some period of time, and one can measure that. Similarly, we have groups that are looking in detail at the morphology. Now, computational neuroscience kind of takes two kind of major approaches to the study of cell firing patterns. One is what are called point models, which essentially ignore the complex dendritic morphology of the cell and simply assume, much like an artificial neural net, that inputs are coming in and they're specified by some previous kind of layer or some previous operation. And if subject to some threshold or some function of that, a computation is made. Well, in real neurons, that it is the details of the synapses, the synaptic proteins, the plasticity, the morphology, and the shape of that apparently may make a very significant difference. And we don't know to what extent it really matters. We do know that we can't recapitulate the firing patterns of neurons really well without considering those morphologies, and we've been able to fit models which actually do very well for a variety of cell types, particularly the ones that have been extracted and studied in this other system. So the idea is to put all these things together in this components part, to have cells extracted from various pieces of the visual cortex in the mouse, or part of that visual processing stream from retina to, say, lateral geniculate nucleus in the thalamus, which is a relay station into the primary visual cortex. And so we can do the physiology, we can do the reconstruction, we can attempt to classify cells and understand their function. So this just kind of summarizes what I had said before, that here you have these, you can build these models that are sort of these, essentially they're general linear models that basically use some advanced function of a linear model to predict firing and spiking. The next level of complexity is you can add kind of compartmental models, but that the dendrites themselves don't really actually have active conductances in it. Or finally, you can do the full morphological operation where you essentially solve these so-called Hodgkin-Huxley equations and really model the diffusion dynamics and charge motion in the structure. Secondly, the next issue becomes one of connectivity of this. You really need to understand, part of cell type and part of understanding function is understanding what's connected to what. This is just, and to approach this in the mouse, to get connectivity, we have we've basically completed an atlas which is kind of a mouse connectional atlas. It's brain-wide, which uses both kind of viral injections, where you basically inject a sort of a virus into an area or a sort of kind of, you know, area of the brain, and it will basically uptake through the neural processes, and then you can image this using kind of fluoresce. It will fluoresce. You can image this using two-photon microscopy, or you can build transgenic mice that are you sort of knock in or knock out for specific genes that you know will either express or not, and then image them to understand how things and the nature of how they're connected. And so the basis of this really became this connectivity atlas that we finished maybe a year or so ago, a couple years ago, that kind of summarizes the mesoscale connectivity of the brain. So the connectomics is a big issue in neuroscience today, and a lot of different groups have studied it. And it's important, I think, to think of the scale, its scale. And typically it's sort of broken up into more or less three kind of major components, what you'd call a macro scale, which would be summarized by really beautiful work, like, for example, in the Human Connectome Project from University of Minnesota and Washington University, which is this sort of large-scale twin. It's a twin study of almost 1,200 twins in the Missouri area and studying their fMRI in resting state and under some functional tasks. And the idea is that one can understand now the major areas of connectivity in a macro way in the brain, or how the brain is parcellated according to that. On the other spectrum, true connectivity of what's connected to what, the sort of the WIJ, if you would, its weight, or the W alpha beta, where if you wanted to restrict yourself to cell type classification, you have to go down to a real micro level. And that's about using these dendritic reconstructions in the morphology, which I just mentioned, to understand, you know, specifically what's connected to what. The trouble with this is that even, let's say, approaching a cubic millimeter of cortex in the human is still, by today's standards, somewhat intractable of a problem. That basically to segment, to compute this, to map the connections, because it has to be done essentially by electron microscopy. And whereas in partnership with some groups like Google, we're approaching this problem, it's still a gigantic problem of machine learning and classification to attempt to understand that microstructure. So this atlas here, in fact, was more done at what you'd call a mesoscale. It's basically showing you major connections between big regions in the brain on a sort of a nucleus-by-nucleus basis. You're not able to see the micro-level structure, but you get much more than kind of the macro structure. Part of the result of that, which was published not so long ago, is this sort of map of connectivity, mesoscale connectivity, which you can see in the lower right-hand corner. So this now gives you, up to this point, what we've discussed is we have these components, understanding the neurons, their characteristics, their physiology, morphology, their transcriptomics, and their connectivity patterns, so that one can sort of understand basic circuitry. And that circuitry has been elucidated by others and in other organisms in some way, although by only using sort of partial information. And we're hoping to kind of add a little bit to that picture by being able to do this morphology, transcriptomics, and physiology in the same cells in the same animal, because you really want to understand how those same cells are behaving. Some of the work of Rodney Martin and others from ETH, I believe, has done nice work on this structural work in the rat. And so, so a lot of this is very transferable and kind of makes sense in the mouse as well. So next, let's move to computation. Like, what do you do with these structures and these primitives once you've you have them? And for this, we're going to sort of use that experimental paradigm that I showed you of the mouse running on this kind of fixed thing and being rewarded for certain object recognition or maybe object classification to build something which we're actually be releasing this data. As I said, we have these regular releases. We've had about 34 data releases since we started in 2003. They occur about every typically two times a year. But in this next one that's coming up in May will be this first rendition of what we call this cortical activity map. In its attempt to understand in some kind of more micro way how stimulus behavior and state may be represented in single cells and population cells in the visual cortex of the mouse in V1 and specifically layer 4, because layer 4 is where information many of you may know that all mammalian cortices, the cortex is divided up into 6 different layers. The gene expression is very homogeneous across these layers in general, but they functionally have very different kind of properties, as we know. So, but the data coming in through the retina first comes to this layer 4, which acts as a kind of preliminary kind of classification area, if you will. So the idea is to understand some of the notion of that. And so the idea is that using that same experimental paradigm, you basically have the mouse now exposed to potentially different kinds of stimuli, from gratings, as which were done by Hubel and Wiesel in the cat, to natural images or sparse noise, things that you can use as controls to understand and to see what they can detect. And how do you measure it? What you measure, let's see, I can make this. Yeah, you're basically using this kind of what's known as a kind of a calcium imaging, in which a kind of something, a kind of protein called GCAMP6 or some variant, which is actually will fluoresce when the calcium channels are active in a cell. And you, by using two-photon imaging, you can detect this. And so you have essentially on that mouse, there's essentially an open head plate where you now can use a kind of wide field calcium imaging to see the firing patterns in some kind of diffuse sense like this of patterns of cells firing in the cortex subject to when the mouse sees various stimuli. And the question is, well, how do you reconcile all this? I mean, I'm just showing you this kind of firing pattern here, and how do you know how it's mapped or architected? Well, you use a kind of an angiographic kind of map. That it turns out that the blood vessels in the mouse's brain are the cortex itself is very flat. It has no real folds. It's called what they call lissencephalic in the lingo. But it basically means that it's very flat and easily transformed to sort of a flat map representation. And you can use these blood vessels as guides for the mapping to understand exactly where the cells are and whether cells are common. This is it's surprising the consistency of that. So that's basically the experimental setup. And so we apply these kinds of stimuli, these gratings and noise, to try to see and if one can sort of backfit or classify what the mouse must have been seeing by only reading the mouse's mind from this a posteriori measurement within a couple of action perception cycles, okay, within about that kind of time frame. And actually you can do pretty well at this. You basically have these images like that we showed in the movie. We will segment them using sort of image processing methods to sort of show the firing patterns of cells and their intensities. We'll be able to measure cell counts, the relative ratios of fluorescence, because we're measuring a kind of fluorescence of it using this calcium imaging, to content, and the time series of these, how they progress over time, and then put those into machine learning algorithms to attempt to deduce what the mouse may have been seeing or learning. So it's kind of a decoding problem. And so that's the nature kind of the computation. And one of the findings of this is that, you know, you might think that in fact, not surprisingly, there's a high degree of correlation. If you do this focusing on single neurons compared to sort of clusters and groups, your performance is significantly diminished. That basically that there's a lot of regional kind of, just like with the gene expression, there's a lot of kind of spatial dependency of firing in these areas, which leads to, which if you exploit, you get much, much more enhanced classification. So one of the things we did was exposing these mice to natural images from these different image databases. And basically, these are similar to experiments. You can think of these as, in a way, as a mouse-controlled experiment parallel to the experiments done by, in the group of Jack Gallant, which is really interesting. What he did was they exposed, had humans look at certain natural scenes, and they trained them on looking at certain natural scenes. And then they just took fMRI scans of the brain and were able, using kind of classification methods, to deduce what the people must have been looking at with quite a high success rate, and actually reconstruct the images based on, you get essentially a reconstruction of what they would have been actually seeing in some really coarse sense. It's quite remarkable. Now, of course, this doesn't work without training. You can't generalize to say, now I take an independent person who had been shown fire trucks, and if you show the next person fire trucks, you're going to see the same signal. But it does work in a trained sense in people. And this sort of thing works really well in mice, that we can actually get, by using the kind of these correlation exploited kind of techniques, both in terms of orientation and grading things, or in terms of sort of natural image decoding, you get pretty high performance rates of being able to reconstruct, simply from the machine learning aspect, what the mice were seeing and perceiving, somewhere in the sort of plus 80 percentile of correctness. So the point is that these natural images, one must really take advantage of the populations and not just individual firing rates as an agglomerate. And so that you have, using more linear discriminant analysis as opposed to more sort of a naive Bayes, you're able to much, much improve your classification rate. So the last component of this sort of cognition thing, is that how would you extend this? Well, we've seen how that there might, you know, we have the components of the mouse's brain. We have some notion of basic circuitry. We understand the structural circuitry from how the architecture of it is from our connectivity maps. We understand now how the response to individual computation in the sense of the response to individual or collective neural firing patterns. But what about a deduction, something that would have to rely a process of discernment in the mouse. And so for that, we're going to use the same kind of paradigm. And what I'm talking about here is all really quite preliminary. We don't have any definitive results in these areas, anything that is kind of what you'd call a truly novel at this point. But this is sort of the paradigm I'm describing for going about proceeding with this program. And so this final part, this cognition part, is you want, it has to be a kind of a notion of a really controlled thought experiment in the mouse. How does the mouse approach some form of discernment? How does it change? And this is the program of kind of these future kind of cortical activity maps. This is just a program of study, in essence, that we've set out for ourselves, where in the first CAM, it's all about attention and Can you get the mouse to recognize and stop at certain things, and what's the nature of it? The second program we talked a little bit about was this object object recognition. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about that. And the third are more advanced things, which we haven't even begun to think about. So this is kind of the program of study of this, if you will. But what about object recognition in the mouse? How would you go about kind of approaching this problem? And so there, let's see. Now you're going to do the very similar kind of experiment, except you can expose the mice to different kinds of objects, shapes, and things. Let's say in this simple illustration here, I'm just showing you this simple thing between squares or triangles, and you can reward the mouse for the perception or stopping at various square or triangle or whatever or things. But we can go beyond that. Is that in fact we can show that the mice are much more capable of a more invariant distinguishing and perception. So that's what really object recognition, a hallmark of it is invariance, of course, which we all know, that you're able to recognize these objects from different perspectives, to generalize to when you've only seen a piece of one to turn it into another thing. And so here we have these artificial objects. I can't remember what they're called. They've got a special name, that a database of things that people have made. They're very artificial, but they look like things that we might recognize. One of them is they're called birds, another are called mushrooms, etc. And in fact, we can conduct experiment to show that these mice can learn to distinguish between these kinds of things. And so what you do is you do similar kinds of things. You measure the trials of their exposure to these different objects, whether they slow down. This is showing their track trials, is that whether it slows down subject to seeing the object or not, and whether or not, and we measure using these calcium image techniques, the perception, whether in fact what they detect. As I said, invariance is the big thing. And so the way you go about this kind of thing is you set them up on a kind of generalization program by showing them different objects from different frames of reference. And in fact, you build a whole matrix of these where the same objects is shown from a whole spectrum of things, but you only train them on essentially a kind of a diagonal of things, a fixed orientation, fixed directions in each one. So here on the right-hand side, you can see that despite this matrix of the full panoply of possible seeing of these mushrooms or these birds, on the right, you see that we're only going to train them on certain representations of the birds and certain representations of the mushrooms. And you do this, and you measure essentially the kind of their essentially response characteristics on these training sets, and you actually can get quite good generalization from this. That it turns out that by measuring these response things in using these imaging systems, that on these off cross other parts of the square, the mice do actually quite well at recognizing and generalizing to seeing these different objects. So these aspects, only a very, very limited time yet, I just want to sort of summarize the notion of this and how it pertains to computation. But what we want to do is essentially build this system, which one of our members has called IC, and it's just a name, but the idea is to build essentially a computational system that can kind of put these pieces together to build a model of visual perception and classification. It's not to say that it is not meant to be to compete with or outperform straightforward approaches to object detection or recognition or expert systems that might be built addressing these problems, but to build biophysically realistic systems that attack this problem in the living organism. So the idea is you start with these, again, using this components to circuits to cognitions program. Again, all these pieces can be put together. I just wanted to show you. See, this is a preliminary simulation that we've built here of using biophysically realistic neurons that we've recorded from, we've reconstructed using our informatics methods. We've built networks of these. We start to observe recurrent firing patterns. We're able to see characteristics that are it's very similar to achieving some of the results that were achieved by, say, the Human Brain Project in Europe on a somewhat smaller scale and a preliminary scale. So that's the big program, is to kind of understand this cognition and perception cycles within a few action cycles in the functioning cortex. And so it's a step in this direction of you when you seeing these images like this, just coming back to this, the incredible amount of information in this and how it is that we as humans can attempt to understand scenes. So this is the work of an enormous number of people. I run the modeling, analysis, and theory people at this institute. It's a group of about 20 of these, several hundred people, and there's too many people to thank, but except for our founders and all the people's dedication. So thank you so much for your time.
Yesterday, John Stoyatomopoulos sort of gave us a lightning tour of genomics, and here we had a lightning tour of sort of neural structure and function, and maybe we've learned how much we still need to learn, but it's pretty exciting. Maybe, does anybody have any questions? Going once, going twice? Okay, thank you then. Yeah.